this topic is structure of immune system. So for this topic, you need to understand the central and peripheral lymphoid organs, cells of immune system and MHC. First of all, structure of immune system. So lymphoid organs are mainly divided into two parts, central and peripheral lymphoid organs. Central lymphoid organs are mainly the thymus and bone marrow, where there is a hematopoiesis takes place. And peripheral or the secondary lymph organs are the lymph nodes, spleen, malt, and that is the mucosa associated lymphoid tissue. And other are the lymphoid cells that all constitute together the immune system. These are the other cells of the immune system, like the phagocytes, neutrophils, eosinophils, basophils. These are the phagocytes. Other than this, dendritic cells, mast cells, and platelets. And cytokines, these are the soluble products secreted from the various cells of immune system. They include the interleukins, interferons, tumor necrosis factors, colony stimulating factors, etc. So all these four things together makes your immune system. The lymphoid organs, lymphoid cells, the cells of other cells of the immune system, and the cytokines. Now one by one we will see the role of each and every one. So first is the central lymphoid organ, bone marrow. So all the cells in bone, blood are originated from the pluripotent hematopoietic stem cells of the bone marrow, that is called as a hematopoiesis, that all you must be knowing. In early fetal life, hematopoiesis occurs in liver. Gradually stem cells migrate to bone marrow. And by birth, the stem cells occupy most of the bone marrow space of the large bones. As the individual ages, hematopoietic activity in large bones decreases, and after puberty, hematopoiesis is mostly confined to the axial bones such as pelvis, vertebra, sternum, skull and ribs. Progenitor T and B cells originate in bone marrow. Afterwards, the T cells migrate to the thymus and the B cells stays there into the bone marrow itself. Second is the thymus. It is a site of proliferation of the and the maturation of the T cells. So develop in the embryonic life from the third or the fourth pharyngeal pouch, and which is active at birth, continues to grow for many years, reaches its peak size at puberty, and then it degenerates. Structure, it is having a two lobes surrounded by a fibrous capsule, and septa arising from the capsule divide thymus into lobules, and each lobule is differentiated into the inner medulla and outer cortex. So this is the structure of the thymus. This is the cortex and inner part is the medulla. So each lobule is having this structure. Now what is the thymus cortex? In the cortex there are thymocytes, cortical epithelial cells and nerve cells, which are specialized epithelial cells with a long membrane extensions that surround many thymocytes. Medulla, it is a sparsely populated with the cells. It is having a less amount of thymocytes. Medullary epithelial cells are there, interdigitating dendritic cell. Here you can see this is an interdigitating dendritic cell. These are medullary epithelial cell. And Hazel's corpuscle, these are the Hazel's corpuscles. They are concentric layers of a degenerating epithelial cells. So these are the constituents of the medulla. These are the thymic hormones that are secreted by the epithelial cells of the thymus. They are believed to attract the precursor T cells from bone marrow. The hormones are thymulin, thymopoietin and thymosin. Maturation of the T cell, it is a cell-to-cell interaction between thymocytes and thymic stromal cells. And because of thymic hormones, that leads to maturation of the T cell. And after maturation, the T cell move to the lymph nodes. Now what is central tolerance? This is a mechanism for prevention of the autoimmunity. The 2-5% of the developing T cells, they become mature and release out from the thymus. What happens to the others? The other T cells, they are not capable of recognition by the MHC complex. So they are degenerated. They are not. They may be self-reactive or they are not recognizing the MHC. So destruction of such a self-reacting T cells prevents the development of autoimmunity. And such a tolerance is called as a central tolerance. What happens if there is a defect in thymus? So it leads to the maturation of the defect into the maturation of the T lymphocytes, that in turn results in a severe life-threatening cell-mediated immunodeficiency disorders. For example, Dejor syndrome, It is a congenital aplasia of thymus. There is a deficiency, there is a defect into the development of the third and fourth pharyngeal pouches with defect in the aorta, and also there is a defect into the parathyroid glands. Nude mice, it is a mice with a congenital absence of thymus. So these two are the main complications or syndromes that are associated with the defect into the thymus. Now comes the peripheral lymphoid organs. In peripheral, first is a lymph node. Small bean-shaped organs are there. They are present throughout the course of these lymphatics. It is distributed all around, all over in our body, and they act as a physiological barriers. They filter the microbial antigens carried to lymph nodes by activating the T and B cells. So what is the structure of a lymph node? It is divided into three parts: cortex, medulla, and the paracortical area. So cortex and medulla, these two are the B cell area, while paracortical area, it is mainly a T cell area. It bears the lymphatic vessels, that is efferent and afferent, and blood vessels. So cortex of the lymph node, it contains the lymphoid follicles that are composed of B cells, few special type of dendritic cells, and occasionally T cells. So this is the structure of a lymph node. Here you can see these are the cortical area, this is a medulla, and paracortical area. So in a cortex, there are two types of follicles, primary lymphoid follicles and secondary lymphoid follicles. So here in picture you can see these are the primary lymphoid follicle and this is a secondary lymphoid follicle. So in primary lymphoid follicles, they are found before the antigenic stimulus. Here there is a resting cells are there. Okay, resting B cells are present in the primary lymphatic follicles, where they are not came in contact with the antigen, and they are smaller in size as compared to the secondary lymphoid follicles. Now what about the secondary? So following contact with an antigen, resting B cells start dividing and become activated. And these activated B cells differentiate rapidly into plasma cells and then into the memory B cells. And the follicles become large, that's called, then it is called as a secondary lymphoid follicles. Now in the secondary lymphoid follicle, there are mainly two areas, central germinal area and peripheral mantle area. The mantle area is having the activated B cells. Paracortical area and the medulla. Paracortical area is present between the cortex and medulla. It is a T cell area. Contains the macrophages, interdigitating dendritic cells, which trap the antigens and present to the T cells. And in medulla, it is innermost part and it is mainly composed of the B lymphocytes that are the plasma cells. Now another peripheral lymphoid organ is a spleen. Spleen is the largest secondary lymphoid organ. It acts as a physiological barrier similar to lymph node, but it is important in clearing of the blood, okay, clearing the microbial antigens through the antigenic stimulation of the T and B cells. This is the structure of spleen. It is mainly composed of a red pulp and a white pulp. It is situated below the diaphragm on the left side of the abdomen. Adult spleen measures about 5 inch in length and weigh about 150 gram, and it is divided into red pulp and white pulp. What is white pulp? It is a central densely populated area, contains T cells and B cells. It is having the two parts. There is a, one is a periarterial lymphoid cell, that is pulse, and second is a marginal area. Okay, so pulse, that is a periarterial lymphoid sheet, it is a T cell area that is surrounding the arterioles, and the B cell area is outside that periarterial lymphoid sheet. So marginal zone, it is mainly composed of the B cells. Red pulp, it is mainly made up of the sinusoids. These are the sinusoids filled with the red blood cells. Older and defective RBCs are destroyed here into the red pulp. What happens if there is a defect in spleen? So there will be a common repeated infections with the this capsulated organisms like Streptococcus pneumoniae, Neisseria meningitidis, Haemophilus influenza. So the patient generally presents with the repeated infections with this bacteria. Another one, lymphoid organ, that is a peripheral malt, that is mucosa associated lymphoid tissue. So wherever there is a mucosa, this organ, organ will be there. Defense mechanism in the mucosal sites to prevent the microbial entry. Here it is composed of lymphoid tissues lining the mucosal sites. They are collectively known as a MALT, mucosa associated lymphoid tissue. It is arranged into two types: loose clusters of lymphoid cells or lymphoid tissues arranged as an organized structure, like in tonsils, appendix, or in Peyer's patches. In a loose cluster, it is seen into the lamina propria of the intestinal villi. That is throughout the course of the intestine. And these are the condensed organized structures. Okay, so tonsils, appendix, Peyer's patches, these are the lymphoid organs. In submucosa, there are Peyer's patches. What is Peyer's patches? It is a nodule of 30 to 40 lymphoid follicles, both primary and secondary, similar to that of lymph node. And in lamina propria, there is a loose clusters of lymphocyte B cells, plasma cells, activated T helper cells, macrophages. Now, in the epithelial layer of these intestine, there are specialized lymphocytes that are called as intraepithelial lymphocytes, that is also called as gamma delta T cells, and secretory IgA and the M cells. These intraepithelial lymphocytes, they are the part of the innate immunity, and they may encounter the lipid antigen that enter through the intestinal mucosa. They does not require any MSC presentation. So these are the one type of T cell called as the gamma delta T cells. Secretory immunoglobulin like IgA, that is dimeric in structure, it is present in the submucosa as well as in the lining epithelium, and it prevents the microbial entry at the mucosal site. So it gives to local immunity. And the M cells, what is M cell? M cells are the specialized type of flattened epithelial cell. Here in the figure you can see these are the specialized type of flattened epithelial cells. They do not have the villi, microvilli. Instead, they bear a deep invaginations. Here you can see these are deep invaginations or pockets in the basolateral side that contains the B cells, T cells and macrophages. And the portal of entry of a number of microbes is through these M cells like Salmonella, Shigella, Vibrio, polioviruses. So these are the enteric pathogens. They enter into the intestine like this. So these are the M cells. So all this constitutes the mold in the intestinal mucosa. That are the, in submucosa there are Peyer's patches, in lamina propria there is a loose clusters of lymphocytes, macrophages. Then in epithelial layer there are intraepithelial lymphocytes, gamma delta T cells, secretory IgA that are dimeric, and M cells. Okay, there are specialized epithelial cells without microvilli. Now comes the cutaneous associated lymphoid tissue. So it is similar to mold, but it is present over the skin. Skin contains a few loose lymphocytes and specialized antigen presenting cells in epidermis, that is called as a Langerhans cells. Now the lymphoid cells. Lymphocytes are the major components of the cells of immune system. Okay, lymphocytes are mainly of two types, T cells and B cells, that is lymphocytes into the in your active immunity, and natural killer cells are the part of your innate immunity. Approximately 10^11 lymphocytes in the body is there, accounting for 20-40% of the total white blood cells in the blood and 99% of the cells into the lymph. Now these CD molecules are important. What is this CD? CD means cluster of differentiation. These molecules are cell surface markers useful for the identification of cells of immune system. Numerous functions often act as a surface receptors, or some CD proteins may help into the cell adhesions. So many of the microbial agents, like many of the viruses, they recognize these CD molecules and then they identify the particular cell, and then it enters into the cell and causes its pathogenesis. So it may act as a cell receptor and also as a cell function as a cell adhesion. As of 2015, CD molecules for humans are numbered up to 364. Now, lymphocytes, there are mainly three lymphocytes, T lymphocytes, B lymphocytes and natural killer cells. And it is also classified as a naive lymphocytes and lymphoblasts. Naive lymphocytes are those lymphocytes which are not came in contact with the antigen, and lymphoblasts who have came in contact with the antigens and they have transformed into the activated state, that is called as a lymphoblast. Naive lymphocytes, resting cells, B and T cells that have not interacted with antigen, they are also called as a small lymphocytes, and their lifespan is small, that is 1 to 3 months. Naive cells, when come in contact with antigen in the presence of cytokines, they become activated and transform into lymphoblasts. They are developed into two parts. One is effector cells and second is a memory cells. Effector cells have actually work against the antigen, and memory cells are for the future response. Effector cells function in a various way to eliminate antigen. They have a short lifespan, and large lymphocytes having a wider rim of cytoplasm. It is a more having a more organelles. Effector B cells are antibody producing, and effector T cells are helper T cells and cytotoxic T cells. So this is a division according to the type of lymphocytes. Memory cells are dormant cells like new cells, but they having a large lifespan. They providing the long term immunity to many pathogen, and they have a capacity to transform into effector cells rapidly on subsequent antigenic challenge. So these are the differences between naive effector and memory cells. Location, so naive cells are generally seen in the secondary lymphoid organs in a primary lymphoid follicle. Effector cells are seen generally in inflamed tissues, mucosal surfaces, and memory cells are present on both the surfaces, both these locations, naive and the effector cells. Cell cycle is dormant in both these. It is only active in the effector cell. Morphology is having a small lymphocytic morphology in both naive and the memory cells as compared to the effector cells, which are large lymphocytes. Lifespan is short for the naive cell and the effector cell, but it is large for the memory cells as its function is there. Function is transformed to the effector cells on primary exposure to antigen. Effector cell have a function to eliminate the antigen, and memory cell, it transforms into the effector cell when there is a secondary exposure to the same antigen. These are the surface molecule, surface markers that are present on these cells by which we can identify whether these are naive T cells, memory T cells, or the effector cells. Okay. So here in CD25, it is generally seen into the memory cells. CD45 is generally seen into the these effector and memory cells having a CD45 RO as compared to the naive T cells. B cells producing IgG types and their affinity. So IgM and IgD is having a low affinity in naive T cells. In effector cells, this IgG, IgA and IgE having a high affinity. And similar affinity is seen into the memory cells. Now about the T lymphocytes. So T cells constitute 70 to 80% of blood lymphocytes. Unlike B cells, they do not have microvilli on their surface. And they bear a specialized surface receptor called as a T cell receptors, TCR. T cell receptor main function is antigen recognition. Unlike B cell receptor, which binds to antigen directly, T cell receptor does not recognize antigen by direct itself, can only respond to an antigen which is processed and presented by the antigen presenting cells such as macrophages. So T cell receptor come in contact with the antigen presenting cell who is presenting the antigen over their surface, and they bind with the CD3 molecule, with the B7 molecule on the surface of antigen presenting cell, and then they will recognize the antigen. Now these are the types of effector T cells. There are mainly two types, CD4 helper T cells and CD8 cytotoxic T cells. So first is the helper T cells. Helper T cells having the CD4 molecules as a surface receptor, they recognize the antigenic peptides that are processed by the antigen presenting cells and presented along with MSC type 2 molecule. As compared to the cytotoxic T cells, they are recognize the MSC class 1 molecule. Helper T cells will recognize MSC class 2 molecule. Now following antigenic stimulus, the helper T cells differentiate into either type 1 or type 2. It is different for different type of immunity, as because of whenever there is a activation of the T helper type 1, then there will be a cell mediated immunity. If there is activation of the T helper type 2, then there will be a humoral immune response. So depending on the type of the helper cell that has been activated, it will lead to the further immunity. T helper 17 cells, recently a third subset of T helper cells has been developed, identified, that produces a interleukin 17 and interleukin 22, and is primarily involved into the recruiting neutrophils, which in turn heals the microbes as well as induce the inflammation. So it may contribute to the pathogenesis of many autoimmune inflammatory diseases such as psoriasis, inflammatory bowel disease, rheumatoid arthritis, and multiple sclerosis. Another subset of T cell, that is the cytotoxic T cell. These are the cells that are actually responsible for the end point effect. Okay, so these are the cells that are responsible for the cell mediated immunity. They have a CD8 molecule and they will recognize the MSC1 molecule. Okay, MSC we will discuss in late after in this lecture. Cytotoxic T cells are involved in destruction of virus infected cells and tumor cells. So this is the scope of the cell mediated immunity. Cell mediated immunity generally acts against the transplantation, tumor, viral infected cells and intracellular, all the intracellular infections. Rare subtypes of T cells are the T regulatory cells. They regulate the immune system. They provide tolerance to self-antigens known as a peripheral tolerance and prevent the development of the autoimmune diseases. So T regulatory cells having a surface marker such as CD4, CD25 and FOXP3. And deficiency of this FOXP3 receptor will lead to this Apex syndrome. What is Apex? Apex is immune dysregulation, polyendocrinopathy, enteropathy, X-linked syndrome. So it is a severe kind of condition that leads to the severe autoimmune disease. Another one is the gamma delta T cell, as we have discussed previously. It is how it differs from the T cells, that is, it possesses a distinct T cell receptor that composed of the gamma delta chains instead of alpha beta chain that is present into the T cells. They lack both CD4 and CD8 molecules and they do not require antigen processing and MHC presentation of the peptides. So they are the part of the innate immunity found in the gut mucosa within a population of lymphocytes known as the intraepithelial lymphocytes. Encounter the lipid antigens that enter through the intestinal mucosa. So here there is a role of gamma delta T cells into the lipid antigen whenever there is a lipid antigens are there. So that was about the T lymphocytes. How many types of T lymphocytes? T lymphocytes are mainly CD4 and CD8. CD4 is again divided into CD helper. It is also called as a helper T cell. In helper T cell 1 and 2, that leads to the CMI and humoral immunity. Then comes the cytotoxic T cells, then the regulatory T cells and gamma delta T cells. They are responsible for the effect against the lipid antigen, that is the innate in nature. Now comes the B lymphocytes. They are the mediators of the humoral immunity and they are 10 to 15% of blood lymphocytes. They are named after their site of maturation, bursa of Fabricius in birds and bone marrow in human and other mammals. So this is the development of the B cells. From the lymphoid stem cell, they are developed into the pro-B cells, then into the pre-B cells, then immature B cells, then it comes out of the bone marrow and reaches to the periphery as into the lymph node. They develop into the mature B cells and then on antigen exposure, they are developed into either effector or that is called as a plasma cell or the memory cells. And these are the structure of the immunoglobulin that is secreted by the B cells, that is the two chains, constant and the light. Immature B cells migrate from bone marrow to the peripheral lymphoid organs and transform into mature B cells following contact with the appropriate antigen. Mature or new B cells, the most mature B cells belong to the follicular B cell type and produce surface receptor, that is IgD and IgM. So these two are the B cell receptors, IgD and IgM. Play an important role in humoral response, immune response. Following antigen stimulus, the mature B cells transform into lymphoblast and with further differentiate into effector B cell, that is the plasma cells or the memory cells. So what is the structure of plasma cells? Plasma cells are oval large with an eccentrically oval nucleus containing a large blocks of peripheral chromatin that typically looks like a cartwheel. In cytoplasm having abundant organelles, it is having a short lifespan of 2 to 3 days. These are the rare mature B cell types, B1 cells and marginal zone B cells. B1 cells they found mostly in the peritoneal cavity coated by surface markers IgM and CD5 molecules but lack IgD. Marginal zone B cells they are present at the edges of lymphoid follicles of spleen and produce in response to the polysaccharide antigens. Now this is the difference between the T cells and B cells. It is important. Origin is same, bone marrow, both T cell, B cell. Maturation, the T cell gets mature in thymus, B cell gets mature into the bone marrow itself. Peripherally, 70 to 80% are mainly T cells. 10 to 15% are B cells. T cell receptors, they are complex with CD3, while IgM or IgD, these immunoglobulins are B cell receptors. CD markers for T cells are 3, 4 and 8. CD markers for B cells are 19, 21, 24. Thymus-specific antigen is present on T cell, it is absent on B cell because B cell never goes to the thymus. Microvilli is not present on the T cell, it is present on the B cell. Okay, so these are the differences between the T cells and B cells. Natural killer cells. These are very important cells both as in innate immunity as well as in the adaptive immunity. They are the large granular lymphocytes. They constitute 10 to 15% of peripheral blood lymphocytes. Derived from a separate lymphoid lineage, and they are similar to the cytotoxic T cells. Macrophages, they are described by the Russian scientist Metnikov. Monocytes, macrophages, they originate from the bone marrow from a separate serial lineage and they form the granulocyte monocyte progenitor cells. Macrophages are motile, travel by amoeboid movement throughout the tissues and are called as a free or wandering macrophages. While some reside in a particular tissue, they become non-motile and called as a fixed macrophages. The monocytes, when they are present in blood, they are the largest cells. They do not divide and they averagely takes 8 hours in the blood and they migrate to the tissues. And then it develops into the macrophages. Okay, when monocytes migrate to tissue, they develop into the macrophages. Macrophages are 5 to 10 folds larger than monocytes. They contain more lysosomes and cell organelles, produce more lytic enzymes and cytokines, possesses greater phagocytic activity and have a longer life in tissues. So this is the structure of macrophages. They are having a pseudopodia for the movement. This is a phagosome and lysosomes. This is a phagolysosomes. These are the different macrophages as per the different tissues. So in peripheral blood, they are named as monocytes. When in tissues, called as macrophages. But according to the different tissues types, they are named different. They are given different names. So in liver, they are called as a Kupffer cells. In brain, it is called as a microglial cells. Kidney, it is called as a mesangial cells. In lungs, called as alveolar macrophages. In bone, it is called as a osteoclast. Inflammatory side, it is called as a epithelial side or multinucleated giant cells, Langerhans giant cells. In connective tissues, it is called as a histiocytes. In placenta, it is called as a Hofbauer cells, and in lymphoid follicle, it is called as a tangible body macrophage. These are the secretory products of macrophages. They release lysozymes, acid hydrolases, elastases, phosphatases, lipases, collagenases. They also produce reactive oxygen intermediates, superoxide, hydroxy radicals, cytokines, growth factors, and coagulation factors. So different molecules are secreted by the macrophages and they are the actually initiator of the immune response. So the first function of the macrophage is the phagocytosis. So macrophages are the principal cells involved in phagocytosis. So here in the figure you can see there is a development of pseudopodia, bacteria has been ingested, phagosome has been fused with the lysosome and then it is killed and then digestion products are released from the cells. Second function of macrophages is antigen presentation. So they are the major antigen presenting cells and they present their antigens to the T cells and the B cells. Then activated macrophages, they release cytokines that in turn activates the another cells. Their secretory products, interleukin-1, interleukin-6, TNF-alpha, interferon-alpha-beta, TNF-alpha growth factors such as colony stimulating factor and following tissue injury, various mediators are secreted from macrophages which help into the tissue repair and scar formation. Dendritic cells, they are having a long membrane of cytoplasmic extensions resembling the dendrites of neurons. So they are called as a dendritic cell as it is shown into the figure. They originate from bone marrow but the pathway is uncertain. So they develop as a separate lineage from the stem cells or may originate from the macrophage lineage. So what are the types of dendritic cells? One is the Langerhans cells. that are present in the skin mucosa, interstitial dendritic cells, interdigitating dendritic cells, and circulating dendritic cells. So these are dendritic cell having a function as an antigen presentation. They expresses a high MSC2 and B7 molecules. And second is the follicular dendritic cells. They are generally present in the lymph nodes, and they are mainly associated with the B cell maturation and differentiation. Here in the other type of dendritic cells like Langerhans cells, interstitial, interdigitating and circulating, they are works as an antigen presentation and they expresses a high MSC2 and B7 molecule. So their main work is here is antigen presentation. But these follicular dendritic cells, they do not associated with the antigen presentation. They are associated with the B cell maturation, MSC2 and B cell molecules are absent, and they are coated with the antigen antibody complexes. So this is the difference between the different dendritic cells. What are the functions? So non-phagocytic in nature, mainly antigen presentation, capture process present antigen, carry high level of MSC class 2 and co-stimulatory B7 molecules, and they are messenger between the innate and adaptive immune system. Follicular dendritic cells, so as I told you, they are not act as antigen presenting cell, they do not express MSC class 2 and B7 molecules. This is a frequent Viva question or in the MCQ that follicular, what is the function of follicular dendritic cell? Granulocytic cells. Granulocytes are a category of white blood cells characterized by the presence of granules in the cytoplasm. So as you know, these are the different types of granulocytic cells. Neutrophils, eosinophils, basophils, they differ from each other by the cell morphology and cytoplasmic staining and the function. So first is the neutrophils. They possess a multi-lobe nucleus and a granulated cytoplasm that stains both acidic and basic. Cytoplasm, heavily granular, several granules are there. They're having a myeloperoxidase, lysosome, defensins, elastase, gelatinase, etc. And they are the 50-70% of circulating WBC. As you know, if you see any CBC report, you see the percentage of neutrophils that is around 50-70% in the normal CBC. Their level is highly increased in presence of infection under the influence of certain cytokines such as interleukin-8. Principal phagocytes of innate immunity, mechanism of microbial killing both by oxygen dependent and independent mechanisms. Eosinophils, they are bilobe, they are having a bilobe nucleus and a granular cytoplasm that stains red with the acidic dye. Eosin. Phagocytic, they constitute only 1-3% of total leukocytes. Number is greatly increased in certain allergy conditions and helminthic infections. And interleukin-5 is believed to be the eosinophilic chemotactic factor. Basophils, they are non-phagocytic. They function as a secretion of certain granules and they resemble mast cells in their function. The granules are rich in histamine and other mediators that play a major role in an allergic response. So eosinophils having a response mainly into the allergy and the helminthic infection. Basophils are mainly activated in case of the allergic responses. Mast cells, they are present in various body sites. They contain cytoplasmic granules rich in histamine and other active substances. They play an important role in the development of certain allergic reactions like type 1 hypersensitivity reactions. So, till now, we have seen the different organs of the immune system. They are divided into the central and peripheral organs. Then different cells of immune system like lymphocytes, natural killer cells, pain lymphocytes, T cells, B cells, natural killer cells. Then we have also seen the different other cells that are associated with the immune response like granulocytes. So now here we come to the one important point that is a major histocompatibility complex. This is an inseparable component of the immune system. It is a complex, it is made up of group of genes coding for a set of host cell surface molecules that bind to peptide fragments derived from the pathogens. So they display them on the host cell surface for recognition by the appropriate T cells. So T cell recognize the antigen as a foreign when it is presented by the antigen presenting cell with the help of MHC complex. So this MHC complex is present almost all the human cells, but first discovered on the surface of leukocytes, hence it was also called as a human leukocyte antigen, HLA. It is located, MHC genes are located on the short arm of chromosome number 6. HLA complex extends over 4000 kilobase pair length, covering more than 100 genes. And these genes are clustered into the three regions. There are mainly three regions, 1, 2 and 3. So here you can see, these are the three regions of this MHC gene. Here class 1, that is divided into A, B and C. Class 2 is DP, DQ and DR. And class 3 is mainly responsible for the coding of the complement, heat shock protein 70 and tumor necrosis factor. So these are the different categories of the MHC complex. Now this is the structure of MHC class 1 molecule. This is a class 1 and this is a class 2. So here you can see there is a mainly two chains, alpha and beta. So alpha is having a three parts, alpha 1, alpha 2 and alpha 3. And alpha 3 binds with the CD8 to the cytoplasmic tail. With the cytoplasmic tail, binds to the cell membrane of the antigen presenting cell. And this is a beta 2 macroglobulin that is present into the molecule. And here the peptide binding site is formed in MHC class 1 molecule is grew between alpha 1 and alpha 2. So this area is the peptide binding site. Here the antigen has been presented to the T cells. Association of the beta 2 microglobulin with the alpha chain is necessary for the expression of MHC 1 molecules onto the cell surface. But in Dowdy cells, a type of human B cell tumors cell which are not able to produce beta 2 microglobulin. So it is observed that they synthesize MHC1 but they do not express them on the cell surface. So it is a one time of defect that leads to the immunodeficiency disorder. So in that defect there is an absence of beta 2 microglobulin. So this is the structure of the MHC class 1 molecule. Here there is alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3 and beta 2 microglobulin. Now we see MHC class 2 molecule. So here there is both the alpha and beta having a two chains, alpha 1 and alpha 2, beta 1 and beta 2, and the peptide binding cleft is made by the alpha 1 and beta 1 in MHC class 2. And both the cytoplasmic tail are seen inside the cell membrane of this alpha 2 and beta 2. They both bind to the CD4. Now MHC class 1 molecules, they are generally present the antigen to the CD8 molecule on the cytotoxic T cells. While MHC class 2, they generally present the antigen molecules to the CD4 class T cells. So this is the difference between MHC class 1 and MHC class 2. MHC class 1 is present on all nucleated cells and platelets except sperms. Now MHC2, it is generally present only over the antigen presenting cells. Which are the antigen presenting cells? So antigen presenting cells are the macrophages, dendritic cells and B cells. These are the main antigen presenting cells. So MHC2 will be present only on these cells. MHC1 will be present on all the nucleated cells and platelets except sperm. MHC1 will present to the CD8 T cells. MHC class 2 presented to the CD4 T cells. Nature of peptide antigen. So generally intracellular. By the cytosolic pathway, the intracellular molecules are generally presented via this MHC class 1 and exogenous antigens are generally presented by the MHC class 2. The peptide antigen could be 8 to 10 amino acid long. It is small in case of MHC1. It is large, like 13 to 18 amino acid long in case of the class 2. Antigen presentation pathway, as I told you, cytosolic pathway in class 1, endocytic pathway, because here antigen is exogenous. So there will be a first development of the endocytosomes and then it will be presented with the help of MHC class 2. Here, the antigens are generally intracellular, so they will go as a cytosolic pathway and they will directly present it to the MSC1. Peptide binding site is alpha-1, alpha-2 group here, as there is no beta-1, and here in MSC class 2, alpha-1, beta-1 group. Alpha-3 binds to the CD8 molecules in case of MSC class 1, and beta-2 binds to CD4 and T helper cells. Now, what is MSC polymorphism? So, each MSC molecule specifically presents a certain antigenic peptide to the T cells. Since there is a wide spectrum of different antigenic peptides derived from various antigens, there is a likewise need of different MSC molecules capable of recognizing these peptides. So, it made possible by the polymorphic feature of MSC genome, by which it is capable of producing a wide array of MSC molecules with a wide, vast antigenic specificity. So this phenomena is responsible for the MSC polymorphism, means any kind of antigen can be recognized by the MSC and it can be presented to the T cells. So these are the different mechanisms. One is the multiple gene loci. Both MSC class 1 and 2 molecules are coded by multiple genes, and gene of each locus codes for a similar but not identical chain. For example, MSC1 molecules alpha chain are coded by any of the three loci like HLA A, B or C, and MSC2 molecules are coded by any of the three loci of class 2 region like DP, DQ and DR loci. Okay? So this will lead to the polymorphism. Multiple LA for each locus. In a given species, extraordinarily large number of different alleles are known to exist for each locus. So MSC genes are one of the most polymorphic genes known. For example, for class 1 MSC region in humans, there are 240 alleles for HLA-A and 470 alleles for HLA-B and 110 alleles for HLA-C. So, MSC class 1 region of any individual would have one of the alleles from each HLA-A, B and C. So, they could be having a multiple polymorphisms. Lots of polymorphism are seen because of this different number of genes. Then third mechanism could be codominant expression. MSC genes are expressed in codominant fashion. The alleles inherited from parents are simultaneously and equally expressed. So it could lead to a codominant expression. Regulation of the MSC expression. So there are certain factors like transcription factors. MSC genes have promoter sequences at their 5' end, which are regulated by certain transcription factors such as CIITA and RFX both bind to the MSC class 2 promoter genes and increases their transcription. And defects into the CIITA and RFX causes one of the form of Bayer lymphocyte syndrome. That means that do not have the MSC expression. Cytokines also influence the MSC expression. Interferon gamma activates the both MSC1 and MSC2 promoter genes, while interleukin-2 increases the expression of class 2 MSC molecules on resting B cells. So these are the cytokines, they have a different influences on the MSC expression. These hormones like corticosteroids, prostaglandins, they decreases the expression of MSC2 molecules. In many viral infections, the viral antigens inhibit various components of the MSC1. For example, adenovirus protein, they inhibit the TAP. Cytomegalovirus protein inhibit the beta-2 microglobulin. As a result, the MSC expression is suppressed. So, these cells, viral infected cells will not be killed. So, these are the viral infection associated expression. Now, these are some examples of the diseases associated with a certain HLA alleles. HLA-B27, if there is a defect, it can be associated with the ankylosing spondylitis, reactive arthritis and Reuter syndrome. DR2 associated with the multiple sclerosis, good posture syndrome, narcolepsis. DR3 associated with the myasthenia gravis, systemic lupus erythematosus. DR3 and 4 associated with the insulin dependent diabetes mellitus. DR4 associated with the rheumatoid arthritis. A3, B14 associated with the hereditary hemochromatosis. So this was about the MSC. This was about the regulation of MSC, and there are mainly two types of MSC molecules. And these are the genes. class 1, class 2 and class 3. How comes the cytokines? What are cytokines? So they are the polypeptides. They are always polypeptide in nature. They are chemical substances which are serve as a messengers, mediating interaction and communication between the various cells of immune system. So which are the major classes of cytokines? Lymphokines, they are produced by lymphocytes. Monokines, produced by monocytes. Interleukins, produced by WBC. And chemokines, involving chemotaxis and other leukocyte behavior. So according to the origin, they are declassified into different types. But they are together called as a cytokines. What are the properties of the cytokines? So growth factors are produced constitutively while cytokines are inducible. They are produced only after the activation of their cells of origin. So cytokines have a broad range of effects. Like autocrine means they act on the cells, similar cells from which it has been secreted. Here in the figure you can see the cell is secreting the cytokine and it itself acting on that cell. Paracrine means act on an adjacent cell, means secreted by one cell and acts on the nearby cells. Endocrine effect means acts on a cell present at a distant site. So here it is endocrine action, it is secreted into the circulation and it goes to the cell that is quite different or at a distance from the cell of origin. Various types of interactions are seen occurring between the cytokines. Pleiotropy and redundancy effect. Pleiotropy is same cytokine having a different action on a different target cell. That is called as a pleiotropy. So here you can see, for example, interleukin 4 is having a different action. Action on the B cell, the action is different on T lymphocytes, thymocytes, and the action could be different on mast cells. So that is a pleiotropy. Multiple types of actions can be seen depending on the type of the targets. Redundancy is different cytokines producing the same effect on the same target cells. So here the multiple cytokines are there, like interleukin 2, 4, 5. They all are working as a same. Only one effect could be produced on the B cell, that is a proliferation of the B cell. So this is a, they together having only one effect, and here a one cytokine will produce a multiple effect. Which are the properties? So they have a synergy and antagonism effect. Two cytokines may augment each other's action, producing a larger effect. That is a synergism, or may oppose each other's action, called as an antagonism. Cascade effect could be there, means after activation of the one cytokine, it will activate the production of the another cytokine. That is called as a cascade effect. Structures, so they are mainly glycoproteins. Molecular weight is generally less than 30 kilodalton. And most cytokines display high degree of alpha helix structure, but no beta structure. They are characterized so far belong to one of the four groups: hematopoietin family, interferon family, chemokine family, or tumor necrosis factor family. So these are the sources and functions of the cytokines. The details are, you can see in your books also. I am going the type of cytokines. One is the interleukin. Interleukin 1 is generally produced by the macrophages, and they are generally acts onto the T cells. So they will act on the T cell and activate the T cells to produce the further interleukin. That is a cascade effect. So T helper cells, it will act on T helper cell, and they will promote the secretion of the interleukin 2 from the T helper cells. They also promote the B cell response, and in the liver they induces the synthesis of the acute phase reactant proteins. Hypothalamus, induction of fever. In macrophage and neutrophil, they increases the expression of these certain genes. So this is a typical any kind of infection. What will happen? First is interleukin 1 expressed by these macrophages, and then it will lead to all these functions of the any type of infection. Then comes the interleukin 2. It is secreted by the T helper 1 cells, and they will induce the proliferation of the T helper cells and T cytotoxic cells and some of the natural killer cells. Interleukin 3 secreted by the T helper cells, natural killer cell, mast cells. Interleukin 4, it is secreted by the T helper 2 cells, and they having a response on the T helper cells. They promote the T helper 2 activity, T helper cell 2 activity, that is a humoral immunity. Here interleukin 2, it is having a cell mediated immunity activity of all. Now these are the another immunoglobulin interleukins, interleukin 5, interleukin 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So different interleukin having a different cells of origin and they have a different activity. Another one kind of cytokines are interferons. These are important. Here the interferon alpha, beta and gamma. So interferon alpha, it is secreted by the leukocytes. They have an antiviral activity. Interferon beta is secreted by the fibroblasts. They have an antiviral activity. Here interleukin gamma, they are secreted by the lymphocytes like T helper cells, cytotoxic T cells and natural killer cells. So they act on the macrophages, they act on B cells, they promote the inflammation and they also act on the T helper 2 cell, inhibits the T helper 2 cell proliferation. So here is the role of interferons. Their origin is important, means which interferon is secreted by which cells. Then comes the tumor necrosis factor, TNF-alpha and beta. TNF-alpha is secreted by macrophages. TNF-beta is secreted by the T helper 1 and cytotoxic T cells. These another cytokines are colony stimulating factors, that is a granulocyte, monocyte, then TGF beta, so this is a tumor growth factor beta that is secreted by the macrophages, mast cells, T and B cells, platelets. They inhibit the T and B cell proliferation and hematopoiesis and they promote the wound healing, promotes the class switching of the B cells to the immunoglobulin A class. So these are the different categories of the cytokines. Interleukins, from interleukin 1 to 12. Then comes the interferons, interferon alpha, beta and gamma. Tumor necrosis factor alpha and beta. Colony stimulating factors, granulocytic and monocytic and tumor growth factor. So this was all about the structure and functions of the immune system, that included all about the organs of the immune system, primary lymphoid organs, secondary lymphoid organs, then the cells of the immune system, then comes the cytokines and MHC molecules.